Okay, welcome to our today's science lesson. The topic for the day being the Bunsen burner and some of the common observations one can make in a lab. In our previous lesson, we looked at the chemistry lab and some of the apparatus that are commonly found in the lab, though we didn't mention all of them, but at least the basic ones were mentioned. And we even went further to look at how you can draw the apparatus. Now, one of the apparatus or the common item that is found in the lab that we looked at was the Bunsen burner. And I say that that is the chief or the main source of heat energy in the lab. Now, remembering what we did on the Bunsen burner, we looked at the structure, how it looks like, and how it produces the two types of flames. Today, we want to go a little bit deeper into that Bunsen burner, the two types of flames, how they are produced, and the properties or the characteristics of the two flames before we look at the other observations one can make in the lab. Remember, in science we say that observation is everything. Out of the observation, conclusions will be made. Make poor observations, then you'll always make poor inferences or poor conclusions at the end of whatever you'll be carrying out in the lab. So today, let's start on the Bunsen burner. So we look at Bunsen burner as the chief source of heat energy in the lab. So let's look at the diagrammatic representation of the burner, though we looked at it in the previous lesson, but we need first of all to refocus on it before we look at the two flames. So the Bunsen burner, we saw it has the upper part, what we call the chimney. And on the chimney is where we have the flame, the two flames as I will be mentioning later. Then below the chimney, we have an air hole. This air hole allows in air to enter. Remember, in combustion, air is important. Air in particular, here I'm talking about oxygen. Remember, air is a mixture and the active part of air is oxygen gas. So it is air that we allow in to enter the chimney to mix with the gas that will be burning. Just below the air hole, but in the inside, we have what you call a jet. We have a jet, and the jet is connected to the outside to a connecting pipe to the source of the gas that is supposed to be burned, which has three names: natural gas, methane, or generally just called lab gas, although that is a common name which is not very correct with the IUPAC way of naming. So you can call it methane or natural gas. Now this jet is the main point where the gas enters the chimney from, but in small amount at high pressure. Remember, if you are letting a material, a liquid or a gas, through a small hole, it will go out at a high pressure. That high pressure pushes the gas to the top of the chimney from this point to this point, the chimney. And as it goes up the chimney, air currents enter the air hole from all directions. But remember, at one time, you may want to limit the amount of air entering through the air hole. So we use what we call a collar. We use a collar to either open or close the air hole by rolling it either up or down, just to make sure the air hole is open. Now, at the bottom part of the Bunsen burner, we have the base. The base is just to give the Bunsen burner stability so that it is stable at whatever point you will have placed it, to give you proper heating abilities or ways the way you are expecting it to give you. Now, let's go back to how the burning is done. I've just said that a gas enters through here from a cylinder, the source. It can be any kind of size for gas cylinder, where now it is giving us the gas. The gas enters the chimney through a point called the jet, which is a small hole, giving us the gas at a high pressure. Because of that, the flame will be seen on top of the chimney. To get that flame, we also require air to enter through the air hole. But as I've said, we may have some situations where you don't want that air to enter. Now that gives us the two types of flames that we always have in our lab. In our previous lesson, I had mentioned that at a time when you are not using the Bunsen burner, there's a way it's supposed to be orientated. It must be kept in a particular way. And when you are using it, there is the way you will have to work on that collar so that it gives you whatever you need. Now, this gives us the two flames, which are, one, the luminous flame, and two, the non-luminous flame, non-luminous flame. Just to review on that luminous flame is that flame that is produced when this natural gas, methane or lab gas, is being burned, but under limited supply of air. That is, no enough oxygen is present during the combustion of the gas. Because of this, the type of flame you will have will be bigger in size. It will be producing a lot of light, flickering around, and it will also be sooty. On the other side, if you open the collar, air will enter, so you will have enough oxygen gas, that's enough air entering the chimney, meaning that you will have what you call complete combustion. The other one was incomplete combustion, but the second one, where you have now enough air entering the air hole to the chimney, you will have what you call complete combustion. This gives us the second flame, which is non-luminous flame. The flame is totally different from the luminous in the sense that by color, luminous was yellow, this one will be blue in color. This one was flickering around, and this one is steady. This one is quiet. You may not know that something is burning, but for non-luminous, it will be producing a roaring sound. Most importantly, the two main things we have always to note, and they are going to develop our lesson today. This one produces soot. Luminous produces soot, non-luminous does not produce soot. And in addition, luminous does not produce a lot of heat energy, while non-luminous produces a lot of heat energy. Now, it is not just good in science to mention issues. You have to confirm by facts. And how do you confirm? By carrying out experiments. So I want us to go through one or two experiments to confirm some of these aspects I've just mentioned, to give the difference between luminous and non-luminous flame. Just working with the top part of the chimney, if we have the two flames, this one will be luminous and this one will be non-luminous. The luminous flame, I've said, it will be bigger in size and flickering around. But non-luminous will be small in size and steady. The two main facts I want us to look at, and using an experiment, is how can we confirm to anyone that truly luminous produces soot and non-luminous does not produce soot? The answer is to carry out an experiment. And the experiment you can carry out is, since in the lab I said previously that the common apparatus, the most of the apparatus we have in lab, particularly chemistry lab, are glass wares. They are made of glass, particularly Pyrex. Pyrex is very good when it comes to even heating. It will not crack that easily. So if you use any glass apparatus, pick of any apparatus, a good one is a boiling tube. Pick on a boiling tube. Have anything in the boiling tube. Using any material you can use, like a test tube holder, you can hold the boiling tube. It's normally held this way. Then set two buns and burners side by side the way I've done it. One of it, close the air hole. So the luminous one, the air hole is closed. The non-luminous, the air hole is open. With the two boiling tubes, have the boiling tube being heated at this point, and have the boiling tube being heated at this point. So you are heating two boiling tubes at the same time. One on the luminous and the other one is on non-luminous. Inside the boiling tube, we obviously have something. You can just use water. You are having water inside. But our point of interest is not what will happen on the water. The point of interest is what is going to happen on the outside of the boiling tube. After a few seconds or even minutes of heating, the observation that will be made on the surface of this boiling tube and on the surface of this boiling tube will give us a conclusion on which flame is sooty and which one is not. And the answer is, the one heated with the non-luminous flame will be black, dark on the surface. In fact, you may not be even able to see the inner contents of that boiling tube, meaning that the sootiness of the flame has coated the surface, has coated covering. We commonly use the word coating. So it has coated the surface of the boiling tube. By coating it, you make the inner contents invisible. Just like I've coated my body with this clothing, you cannot see my body because I've coated my body. So the same will be seen on the boiling tube. But looking at the one heated using the non-luminous flame, it will still be clear, very clean, and your eye will be comfortable seeing whatever is inside the boiling tube. That is an experimental practice that we have done to confirm that it is true, non-luminous flame is sooty, luminous flame is sooty, and non-luminous flame is not sooty. The other experiment I will wish us to carry out is to show that luminous produces less heat energy and non-luminous produces more heat energy. With the same, we have the two flames. We have our two dear flames, non-luminous and luminous flame. Now remember, we said that among the apparatus we have in the lab, there are those that are used in measurement. And when doing any measurement, particularly that of volume, remember the apparatus I mentioned for the measurement of volume, there are those that have fixed volume and those that you can get varying volume. Pick on any apparatus. You can use even a measuring cylinder. We also have another apparatus by the name a beaker. You can pick on a beaker or any container you can use for heating. We can as well reuse a boiling tube, because a boiling tube is one of the apparatus that is well recommended for heating. Now, using a measuring cylinder, measure equal volumes, of water into a boiling tube. So we shall have a boiling tube, one, and a boiling tube two being heated on the in the two flames. So you have measured equal volumes. We can go for 10 mils. You can go for 10 mils of water. After measuring 10 mils of water into a boiling tube, boiling tube two, it is held using test tube holder. Start your stopwatch. Remember, a stopwatch is one of the implements that is found in the lab used in measurement. But now on that one, you are measuring time, not volume. Now, why go for the stopwatch? You really want to see how much time one requires for water, the 10 mils of water, to boil when you are heating with an unluminous flame, and the same 10 cubic centimeters or mils of water to be boiled by luminous flame. I think it will be a good venture, very exciting for you to do it and to find out. After doing it, you will discover that within a short period, the water being heated by the non-luminous flame will soon start boiling, as the one being heated by the luminous flame will still be very far. You can still use, instead of a stopwatch, you can still use a thermometer. Remember, for water to boil, you require 100 degrees centigrade. 100 degrees centigrade. But remember, 100 only applies at sea level. If you move to other areas, water may boil at a lesser temperature. Like if you go up on the mountain, water can as well even boil at 70 degrees centigrade, 60, 50, depending on how high you are above the sea level. So you can as well use a thermometer and not a stopwatch to check on the time the water will have taken to boil. Now, using the thermometer, you will see you can target a certain temperature. You can say how fast, which one will hit the target of 50 degrees centigrade earlier than the other. Not really going by the time, but the one that will hit the target of, let's say, 50 degrees centigrade will be said to be the best type of flame to use, because it will be producing a lot of heat energy. And I'm sure, just like what we have seen, the non-luminous flame will hit the target earlier, because it is producing more heat energy than the luminous flame. So those two experiments are proving to us that surely the two flames are different, and whatever I've mentioned can easily be confirmed in an experiment in the lab. Now, I want us now to choose the best flame of these two. The best of the two flames. Looking at the primary point of interest in the lab when it comes to a Bunsen burner, then we have to look for that flame that will provide us with a lot of heat energy, and that is the non-luminous flame. The chief point of interest in our use of a Bunsen burner is to provide heat energy. But remember, we also have to look at cleanness. So non-luminous flame takes the mantle because it is clean and produces a lot of heat energy. That is to do with the heating. But remember, we also have rules in the lab. And one of the rules we said is to do with the safety. Safetiness in the lab. Very important. You may be carrying out a very good experiment, but since you are awkwardly behaving in the lab, you may have a very serious injury or accident that may stop that good experiment to proceed. So one of the safety rule here is make sure you keep your flame visible if you are not using it. When not using it, keep your flame visible. So what do? Close the air hole which was open in the non-luminous flame so that it produces luminous flame which is visible. Having felt happy that now we have confirmed that truly non-luminous flame is the best flame to use in the lab during heating, let's understand a little bit more about this non-luminous flame. Now in the non-luminous flame, when on this chimney, it has regions. The non-luminous flame has regions. And we need to understand which region has which type of characteristic. Why do we look into this? We need to understand at what point should you place whatever object you are heating. The flame can be good, yes, but you may not get the best out of that flame if you don't place whatever you are heating at the correct point or position. So if this is the flame, the outer part of the flame, it will have regions. Now, the outer region will have some other colors, not really blue. You may see a green layer on that flame. But my point of interest is this inner part. Point of interest is the inner part of the flame. The inner part of the flame. Is it really a flame? And if it's not, what is it? Then how do you go about placing the object you want to heat in this flame? So, the outer part of this flame is truly a flame. But the inner part is unburned. This unburned gas. The natural gas, the lab gas, or the methane gas that is entering the chimney to undergo combustion. So this unburned gas, which is not a flame, cannot be used for heating. But as I've said, and it is always by nature in science, you don't just say something and agree with it without confirming. So we have to look for a way to confirm that truly this inner part of this flame is an unburned gas, is not a flame. The best experiment you can carry out, it will be so interesting. When you enter the lab, try out this one. Have a matchstick. You can have a matchstick. Then, using a small pin, you can pierce through the matchstick and let the matchstick not be so long. After the pin, the length from the point of the pin to the head should be around 1 centimeter. This one is just 1 centimeter or less. Because if it is more than that, it may enter a certain region that will not give you the results that are required. So 1 centimeter or less. So 1 centimeter to 0.5 centimeters can give you good results. Now, after you have done that, insert the arrangement of the pin and the matchstick in this chimney. So there we have the matchstick has entered. And the head is here, then we have our pin across. So the pin is helping the matchstick rest at a particular position. And make sure it is put at the center. If you look at it from the aerial view, let the matchstick be exactly at the center. so that the pin now will have gone through and it is resting on it that way. This is before you light the Bunsen burner. That is before you light the Bunsen burner. All of this arrangement is being done before the lighting of the Bunsen burner. Once the whole setting has been done, then you can ignite. Igniting means just light the Bunsen burner. What do you expect when a matchstick comes in contact with the flame? I'm sure you have once encountered that when you are still at least a small child, chicky. You encountered maybe a matchstick, and accidentally or just doing it intentionally, you threw one or two matchsticks in maybe a burning fire. And I'm sure you are very happy with what happened. It kind of did a certain sound of an explosion to show that the head gets burned. So that's the thing I'm sure you will be expecting in this case. But is it true that that's the observation you'll make? Obviously not. You will not get that observation. You will find that after a minute or two or even 10 minutes or whichever the period of the Bunsen burner burning, if you put off the Bunsen burner, you will still get your matchstick back as it was originally, not yet burned. Where is the logic? The logic is in this region. This region I've talked about as unburned gas. So the gas, being a gas and not a flame, it will not be able to burn the matchstick head. That will have confirmed to us that indeed the inner region of an unluminous flame is unburned gas, and therefore it cannot be a good region for heating. Another way to look at it, is by having a wooden splint in the lab. You have a wooden splint in the lab. Then, just in a burning flame, put in a wooden splint. This is a wooden splint. Put a wooden splint across the flame in that region as I've shown. Across that unburned gas region. Let it stay there for some time. Take around 30 seconds to a minute. Then remove the splint. What do you see? You will discover that two regions of the splint will be black in color. I've shown it with white, but it will be black in color. Note, this is black, so I cannot show it using white. So let's assume this black is now the wooden splint. The region, as I've shown, this at this part and this part will show blackness in color, showing that it has been burned. But the inner part or the center part will be unburned. What does it show? The unburned gas is a gas and not a flame. The other experiment is using a cardboard or any hard paper, not a light paper. You can pick on any hard paper and kind of close the flame. You close the flame. So if you have your hard paper and you come with it, close the flame. So which means this other part of the flame will not be seen. But the flame will be under the cardboard. Leave it for around 30 seconds, then remove it. What do you see? You will discover that your cardboard will have made a circular observation, and this circular observation is this part will be black. showing that it has been burned. But the center part will not have been burned, showing that the center part is not aflame. So the three experiments are giving us one particular observation. And the observation shows that the center part of the flame is not good for heating since it is an unburned gas region. But now, then where are you supposed to locate any material that is being heated by a Bunsen burner? The best position to locate any material being heated by a Bunsen burner is at this region. That's the region to locate any substance that is being heated, so that you can get all of the heat energy from the Bunsen burner. Now that is all to do with the Bunsen burner and the procedures on how you are supposed to heat any material using the Bunsen burner. But as I said, safety comes number one. You have just used the Bunsen burner using the non-luminous flame. What are you supposed to do next? There are only two things you are supposed to do. One, switch off the gas. That is, put off the Bunsen burner. And if you still feel like you want to use the flame in a few minutes from now, then you don't have to switch off the gas. That is, you don't have to switch off the Bunsen burner, but you switch it into another mode. And the mode is into the luminous flame mode. Close the air hole. Just screw the collar to go and close the air hole so that you don't have enough air entering the chimney to create complete combustion, but to close the air hole so that you don't have enough air entering to have what you call incomplete combustion, which gives you luminous flame that is bright enough to be seen. But also remember, since you have been working or you are going to work with the Bunsen burner, make sure your clothing is not loose. If you have any loose clothing, like maybe your shirt and unbuttoned, it is long sleeved and unbuttoned, you either fold it or button it, but the best is you fold it. If you have a tie, you can either remove it or fit into your shirt or blouse. If you have long hair, tie it from the back so that you don't have anything loose near the flame. Otherwise, it might create a very bad day for you and everyone in the lab. Now, after having seen the Bunsen burner and the good things it does, remember in the some of the experiments we have been using to describe whatever the Bunsen burner does required some bit of measurement. So this one takes us to the second part of our lesson, and that is the common observations. The common observations you should be able to make in the lab, and how accurately or well are you supposed to go about it. So we look at observations. We look at observations in the lab. Observations in the lab. Now, as a scientist, you are a young scientist, and it is good you become a scientist. We saw science makes us make rational judgment in life, in so many things, like when I mentioned the issue of being knowledgeable enough when it comes to voting. Australia is really looking forward to either use or not to use nuclear energy as a source of electricity. And for you, at one time, you may be asked to be a voter to say yes or no. You don't just say yes, neither do you say no. You must do it at an understanding point of view. So these are some of the things you are supposed to know for you to make rational judgment. Now, in observations, science observation is a bit unique to the way others perceive observations. When we say observation, we chiefly mean the use of the five senses. The use of the five senses. The biggest sense that is commonly used in the lab being the eyesight. Most of the observations we make in the lab are based on the eye, but not all. We have the eye, we have the ear. How would you know that a bomb has just been blasted somewhere? How would you say effervescence, that is the fizzing sound, has been produced? You must be using an ear. That is observation. Maybe you are producing or manufacturing a gas in the lab. How would you know that you have achieved what you wanted? You want to produce esters, sweet, pleasant smelling compounds in the lab. Pleasant smelling compounds. You are just producing perfume. How would you know that the perfume you are producing has been gotten? You have to use another sense of the nose. But maybe you have just been reacting substances, and this substance, you don't know whether it is producing heat energy or is not producing heat energy. How would you tell that heat energy is produced? At least you have to feel the substance. Feel it. Is it hot? Is it cold? So the sense of feel, the skin, the sensory nerves must also be working. So for us to use all these senses, then we say you are making observations. And in making those observations, correct observations, you make correct recordings. So the first thing is do observation. After observation, you immediately make recordings. In science, we don't work with remembering observations for recording. You do the experiment and immediately record. Remember, there are no errors allowed in science, because an error may cost something very big. So to avoid errors, if you are doing an experiment, whether in a group or individually, remember we say that science is a teamwork activity. So even if you are doing it in a teamwork form, remember every step you do that requires for you to record any observation made, do it immediately and using all the senses. Now, when recording, you also record it correctly and sincerely. Correctly and sincerely. You don't record as per what you are imagining. You record as per what you have observed. If you are imagining that the temperature is supposed to go low, and now the temperature is going high, don't record it as going low. Just record the way you have seen it, and so on. So in the observations, we have measurements that we always go for. We have measurements that we go for, and measurements are in so many ways. There are measurements. So in these observations, we have measurements. And these measurements, we have several types of measurements. There is what to do with the length, terms of length, measurement in terms of length. In science, the common ways on how to measure length is by using different instruments that you may be learning maybe in other topics in science, of the instruments we normally use. But in science, particularly under chemistry, we are mostly interested in units. So the units we go for when it comes to length is in terms of meters. We have centimeters, Then we have millimeters. Millimeter being the smallest, meter being the biggest. But in the case you are also talking about a very long distance, then you can talk about kilometers. Kilometers, which is now bigger than meters, but these are the common two, three units that you can commonly use. Meters, centimeters, and millimeters. That is to do with the length. Then we also have measurement to do with the mass. Mass. Mass is just the issue of looking at how heavy or how light a substance is. Remember, in chemistry, as a branch of science, we always talk about accuracy. Accuracy. Look at a situation where a drug, a tablet, has been manufactured, which is to be used for curing a certain ailment. And you discover that though it is the same type of a drug, there are different sizes of that tablet with a different chemical composition. Will you be comfortable? I'm sure not. So those drugs, those tablets, are always produced in the same size with the same chemical composition because of what we go for in terms of measurement of mass. The mass used for that active ingredient in the tablet must be the same so that the doctor can give the correct prescription of that particular drug to cure whatever it is supposed to cure. Now, to do with the mass, starting with the biggest unit, we have a ton, 1 ton, which is 1,000 kilograms. Then we have kilogram. Then we have grams. Tons, 1 ton, which is 1,000 kilograms. 1 kilogram, which is 1,000 grams. And 1 gram. These are the three common units we normally use in measurement of mass in the lab. The other measurement unit we can talk about is volume. Volume, this is commonly to do with the substances that are either in a liquid state or in a gaseous state. Liquid state or in a gaseous state. But remember, in a gaseous state, is a little bit hard to handle. We require very special apparatus for measurement of volume for gases. But for liquids, it is so easy. You go in the lab and you'll be comfortable to deal with any of those apparatus. Now, in measurement of volume, it is normally done in liters. It can be done in milliliters. But it is also called centimeter cubed or cubic centimeter. So you'll find that in some cases, you'll be using cubic centimeter and some will be using milliliters. The other measurement, which is now different from these three, the measurement which is different from the three, and why I'm saying different from these three are what we call system international units. System international units. System international units. SI units. Commonly shortened as SI units. In full, it is a system international units. But we also have those that are also used in measurement, but they are not inclusive in that, and that is to do with the time. Measurement of time. Remember, in our previous demonstration experiment description of how to check on which flame is hot, we talked about using a stopwatch. What are we looking for? The time taken for non-luminous or luminous to do whatever it's supposed to do. So when we are looking at time, we have different units here, and we have the hour, we can have hours, we can have minutes, and we can have seconds. Most of the recordings, in chemistry as a branch of science, we mostly go for seconds. That is to do with the time. Though all the others are acceptable, but the common mode of units we go for is seconds. The other measurement is to do with the temperature. Temperature. Measurement of temperature. In the temperature, we measure, there are two scales we normally use. There's what we call the Kelvin scale, and there's also what we call the Celsius scale. The common one being the Celsius scale, degrees centigrade, commonly called degrees centigrade. The units are degrees centigrade. That is the Celsius scale. That is to do with the measurement of temperature. Now, in all these modes of measurements, we need to identify which one is commonly used. Which one is commonly used? As much as all of them are acceptable, but there is one that is always more common than the other one. So for temperature, it is the degrees centigrade. Remember, we also have the Kelvin scale. But the common one is degrees centigrade. Then for time, we have seconds. For volume, it is either milliliters or cubic centimeters. These ones are equal. They are equal. It's only that the wording is different. Then for mass, we use grams. And for length, we use milliliters. We use milliliters. Now, there's something I need to clarify a little bit here. That is to do with the volume. Remember I said the common way we can deal with the volume is measuring a liquid. How about a gas? So when it comes to a gas, in measurement of volume of a gas, there are also other units that you may encounter later on in your study of science, and that is decimeter cubed. Decimeter cubed. So decimeter cubed is just 1,000 milliliters or 1,000 cubic centimeters. So this is also another unit that you may encounter in the future, and you wonder why it wasn't maybe mentioned. So it is there, but it's commonly used in gases. Decimeter cubed. 1 decimeter cubed is equals to 1,000 cubic centimeters or 1,000 milliliters, but is equal to a liter. So 1 liter is the same as 1 decimeter cubed. Now, having seen the modes of measurements we have seen being commonly being applied in the lab, we also need now to see how accurately do you get these units. You don't just say the volume is maybe 10 milliliters, or it is 10 grams, or the temperature is 10 degrees centigrade. There's a way you have to read the instrument or the apparatus and the way you are supposed to record. So our point of interest in the second, as we finalize our lesson, after the measurement, let's look at reading and recording. Reading and recording. Reading and recording. If you go wrong here, then all that you did previously goes to waste. You have done your experiment very well. You have done your observations very well. Out of these, out of the measurements you did, you made the observations. You are doing the measurements. You did the experiment. You made your observations using your five senses. But at the end of it all, you didn't do correct reading of all the measurements you are doing, correct reading of the observations you are making, and at the end, you didn't do correct recording. With the wrong recording, poor analysis or inference, we call it analysis or inference, of whatever you are doing will be done. Meaning that at the end, conclusion will be poor. And you can easily be termed a very wrong scientist, which I don't want you to be. I want you to be a good scientist. So let's look at how to make good reading and recordings of these instruments, some of the instruments we have just mentioned. Now, in making a reading, starting with the apparatus to do with the volume, for example, measuring cylinder, then there's also apparatus to do with the temperature, and that is a thermometer. You have a thermometer which has a mercury thread with the calibrations. This measuring cylinder also has calibrations. How would you make correct reading of these apparatus? These are very common apparatus you are going to be using since your year 7 as you proceed in your studies. The best way to go about this, make sure the terminal point of the point of reading is at your eye level. So if this is the last point, that is the last point of this mercury thread. To make a reading, your eye level must be at the same point, such that the point of vision should be 90 degrees at this point. It should be 90 degrees. So this one, 90 degrees. The same applies to if you have a liquid in this measuring cylinder. The reading is usually done at the bottom of the meniscus. So you don't make the reading at this point. That's wrong. The reading is done at this point. That is correct. So the upper part is wrong. The lower part is correct. So at this correct point, your eye should be perpendicular to that. That is at 90 degrees. This one, you will do a correct reading of the measurements to give correct observation, and at last, you will get correct recording. Remember, every measurement you do, every practice you do in the lab, record immediately. Record immediately to avoid errors. Now, the other issue to note is, how do you then record? This is just making a reading. I've made a reading. Let's assume at this point it is 10.5. And this one, it is, if this one is 21 and this is 20, this mercury thread is at this point. What are you supposed to record here? This is a point of contention, because some usually get it hectic on how to record this. Looking at it, It is not yet at the center, because center part, this is the middle point, where you can say maybe it is 20.5. But it's not yet there. But it is past 20. Then what are you supposed to record? Let's start with the one of volume. Here, when it comes to recording, make sure you do it at one decimal point. One decimal point, because most of the apparatus we use in the lab are to give us an accuracy of one decimal point. But in case you use more accurate apparatus, like we also have some apparatus used in the measurement of volume used by research institutions. If you are lucky to have such an apparatus, it will have two decimal points. So you can record it as 10.50, because it can give you either a 0 or a 5 as the second decimal point. But for the common apparatus we have, it only gives one decimal point, which will be 10.5. In case you record a two decimal point and the apparatus you are using has an accuracy of one decimal point, then it means you are not sincere with your recording. Remember, I said in a science, whenever you are recording, be accurate, be prompt in the recording, and be sincere. So if you record 10.50 and the accuracy of the apparatus is one decimal, that is 10.5, then it means you are not sincere with your results that you have just recorded. That is to do with the volume. Now let's look at temperature. When you get such a situation, temperature can only be recorded in this format. Either 20.0, 20.5, or 21.0. So these are the out of these three, we have the correct answer to this reading. There is no any other reading we can make. So what does it tell us? There is nothing like 0.1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9. We only have a 0.0 or a 0.5. Now, on your own, just taking a few seconds, which one is the correct reading? I'm sure if you are more than one there, there's one who is saying this one is correct. There's one who is saying this one is correct. And another saying this one is correct. No, which one is wrong and which one is correct? This one, this point is more than 20.0, but less than 21.0. So it can't be 20.0 because it is more than 20.0. But it can't be 21.0 because it is less than 21.0. So this one is wrong. This one is wrong. This one comes out to be correct. Why? Because if you look at this mercury thread, it is not yet 20.5. But if you look at the middle point of 20.5 and 20.0, which is at this point, that's the middle point. It is past the middle point, the middle quarter from 20.0. So if it is past the middle quarter, then it goes to the higher quarter, which is now 20.5. Let's look at this other case. You have this. This is the middle point, lower point, and the mercury thread is to this point. And this is the quarter point. This is 20.0, 20.5, 21.0. What will be the reading? The reading is 20.0. The reading there will be 20.0. Why? Because the mercury thread is still lower than the middle point of the first quarter. It is not past the first quarter. So this gives us a 20.0. You go down. If it were this, it is to this point. It has just reached, covered the first quarter. It has just covered the first quarter. Then where do you go to? At that point, you have two options. There are those who will feel like going down, and those who will feel like going ahead. Just like maybe you are crossing a very long bridge, you just reach at the center of the bridge, and maybe there is no any other way out. A vehicle is coming, the bridge is narrow, you cannot share the bridge with the vehicle, maybe it's carrying a very wide load, so you only have one option. Run away from the bridge. Where do you run to? Is it to the front or at the back? Remember, you are at the center of the bridge. There are those who will run to the front. There are those who will run to the back, but they will have covered the same distance. The same applies here. So whoever will go in front, the answer becomes 20.5. And whoever will be at the back, will go to the back, it is 20.0. That's all about measurement of temperature and volume. And maybe to finish off, we have to understand that in all these readings to record, we have to understand that we have what we call quantitative and qualitative observations. Quantitative and qualitative observations. When you talk about qualitative, quality, what is inside? What is inside? And whatever is inside cannot easily sometimes be visible. Remember, I said that the most common observation sense we use is that of eyesight. So quality is in most cases never visible. Though in some cases they can be seen. But when you talk about quantitative, is what you can be able to observe. So in science, particularly in chemistry, you will always be doing experiments. And in those experiments, you will either be looking for either quantitative or qualitative. Quantitative or qualitative aspects of that experiment. Just maybe to give an example, when you talk about quantitative, quantitative is like, when I was heating that water using a luminous flame and the luminous flame to compare, the temperature of water had to rise from 10 degrees centigrade to 89 degrees centigrade in 2 minutes using luminous flame. But the same temperature change from 10 to 89 degrees centigrade, it took 30 seconds for non-luminous flame. That is quantitative. You have quantified the amount of time. You have quantified the amount of temperature. Quantitative. But in qualitative, you may not be able to identify some of those aspects. Maybe you have salt water and pure water. You are heating the two waters using the same type of flame. And you discover that the temperature rise in the two liquids is different in the same time. You are being asked to explain why. Is it easy, before you do any further experiment on the water, to know what could be the reason why the temperatures are different? I'm sure not. Until you do an experiment, you will not be able to tell why this one had to rise so much and this one didn't. That is the qualitative aspect of the water. You want now to look at the qualitative aspect of the water. Again, after you have seen the issue of qualitative and quantitative, you have to note that in all experiments, we work out to predict the future. In all experiments, we work out to predict the future. And how do you predict? By using what you have just done as an experiment, maybe through measurement, done the observations, from the observations, done the correct reading, from the reading, you have done the correct recording, then from the recording, you do a correct analysis, then from the analysis, you now predict. You predict. When it comes to prediction, without correct previous steps, prediction will always be wrong. Just to give you an example is, you have sugar crystals. Big cube of a sugar crystal and small crystals of sugar. You dissolve these two in two different containers of water, same volume of water. What will you see? The smaller crystals will dissolve faster than the big one. The smaller crystals will dissolve faster than the big one. This is an observation you made in terms of measurement of time. Observation made because of measurement of time. You made observation by seeing that this one has fully dissolved within a short period. This one hasn't dissolved within a short period. You made the reading of that measurement of the water, that the water was the same. Reading of the measurement of time. And from that, you did the correct recording of time in terms of how long it took this one to dissolve and this one not to dissolve. You also made a recording of how much water was used to dissolve. Then do the analysis. The analysis is where you will be saying this one took a shorter period, longer period, or this one dissolved very well. This one did dissolve very well. You are doing an analysis. Can you predict? The prediction is the question I'm posing to you. Predict the analysis you have done on the recordings and the measurements you have done. And the answer is, if I get fine crystals of sugar, they will dissolve much faster than small crystals of sugar. That is a prediction. These ones are now much smaller than this. You have predicted, you haven't done this experiment. You did this and this. But now you are predicting a more refined sugar will dissolve much faster than smaller crystals of sugar. So, in our today's lesson, we have looked at several issues. One being the Bunsen burner, which is a very important source of heat energy in the lab. We have also looked at how to go about doing our measurements in the lab, because remember, in all experiments, we have to work with the known amounts of whatever we are doing, or we have to quantify everything that we are working with. So that gave us the measurement bit of it, and in the measurement, you have always to remember the units. We have the system, the internationally accepted system, the SI units. But in addition, we also looked at the temperature and the time as units for measurement in the lab. Then out of that, we have also seen that you have to orientate yourself in a proper way to make correct readings of these instruments for you to get the best. But having done all that, one of the most important parts is correct recording. Without correct recording, you will always make correct judgment of whatever you have been working on. Probably it has taken you a very long period, a day, days, or even weeks. We have experiments that can last weeks, and you can imagine with the poor recording, all that work will have gone to waste. Then from the correct recording, you do an analysis that will assist you do a prediction. This prediction is what scientists always do to make our life move. And it is the one that makes scientists to have that urge of improving on what we have at the present. Having new things coming day by day. That marks the end of our lesson today. Till next time, thank you.